Minnesota farmers are facing the impacts of a changing climate. This includes periods of drought. When we do receive rainfall, it's in much heavier amounts that can cause erosion and runoff. So there are climate smart practices that help us meet these resource concerns. Things such as cover crops help us to keep a living root in that soil to not only provide protection from wind and water erosion, but also feed that biology in the soil. Researchers across the region have been looking at how do we incorporate cover crops into our farm operations, and how do we do this in a way that is not only sustainable and helps us meet our resource concerns, but is also profitable for the farmer. The work being conducted by Jodi DeJong-Hughes and the University of Minnesota Extension is very important not only to farmers in Minnesota, but also organizations such as NRCS to help us guide not only our programs, but all of our technical information that is backed by research conducted in Minnesota in farmers' fields.
We're at Glenn Jelly's farm, and we have done some research plots out here. What we wanted to look at was planting cover crops in the fall before the corn has come off, and then planting our soybeans into them, and it's called planting green. We wanted to know what time to kill out the rye. When does it become detrimental to the soybeans? Farmers have been telling us for many years that they can plant green and have a very successful soybean crop. So what we wanted to do was check that out and have numbers to go with it. So we have 6 locations and 2 research and outreach centers, and it was really a proof of concept. The whole thing is the same variety, planted on the same day. Everything is treated the same except for the rye that's out there and when we terminated it. And we let the farmer use whatever tillage he's using. So some of them are no-till, some of them are chisel plow. The tillage that Glenn used here was fall vertical till, which is a coulter pass where you only go about 2 inches deep, and it mainly is just good for residue decomposition. We have 12 plots out here. So we have the vertical till by itself, terminating the rye 2 weeks to a week before we planted, the day of planting termination, and then terminating a week to 2 weeks after planting, and then they're replicated 3 times. We'd like to keep the soil covered over the winters, and by putting in rye, then you have this cover over the winter, and it starts growing in the spring before we're even out there being able to do tillage. And since it's growing, and rye can be a little competitive, we want to know what stage should we kill it so that the beans have a good chance of getting good yield. So all these plots started last fall. And we had 2 that were wheat that were going to soybeans, and we had 3 that were corn for grain going to soybeans, and 1 that was silage that went to beans. This one here was corn last year, and then we couldn't find a high boy, so we had a drone that interseeded the rye into this plot. We had great rain, and the rye germinated at all the fields, which that in itself was quite an accomplishment. And then this spring, it was a really late spring for planting, so the rye actually kind of got away from us. In some of the plots, the rye was chest high before we could terminate it. So we're showing the extreme of residue cover from the rye this year. So we terminated the rye with just glyphosate, and we came out with an ATV and a sprayer because they're only about 24 rows each plot, and we want to make sure we didn't have drift problems. What we would like to have is a high boy that can go into the field and is taller than the corn and it won't run down the corn. And then the second choice that farmers can have is aerial applying, but we had certain strips in here that had no rye. And the only way that we could get that kind of precision is by using a drone. And the drone last year had a smaller tank, so we actually had to go over the plot 3 times to get the 60-pound rate that we wanted. This year they've upped the size of it and they can actually put down 60 pounds in 1 shot. It's really good at precision seeding. It did not go over the lines. Every once in a while there was a few seeds into the other plot, but really not much at all. So I was really happy with how precisely it could put that down. And also I just liked it being closer so that the seed didn't get caught up in the whorls quite so bad like it would with an airplane. So there's pros and cons to both of them. The drone right now is more in its experimental side, and so it's kind of expensive. If we would have had where we could apply rye across the whole field, then a plane would have done just fine. So last year the rye was put in around September 10th in most of the plots. This year, because of the rainy spring, we didn't get the beans in until probably 3 or 4 weeks later than what we usually plant. What we found is if you had too much rye, it kind of stunted the growth of the beans, and so they're just maturing later than the plots that the rye was not in the way. This year I think we actually might have a yield hit because the rye got to be shoulder height and heading out before we were terminating it. Now, because it's research, we can do that. We know we're going to get a yield hit. But farmers, if they start seeing it heading out, I would go and kill it earlier than what you had expected. So you got to kind of keep your eye out on the rye and see what stage it's in so that it doesn't hurt your primary crop. So these plots for next year, we're going to keep the same treatments because the weather is going to be different and we're going to get different cover crop growth. And that way we can get that range of low residue all the way up to way too high of residue. And we'll be able to give really good recommendations on when we should terminate this rye. And we also replicate it, which means that we have it across the field, all these treatments. And the importance of that is the field is so variable. We want to know if terminating the rye at a certain time either helped or hurt yield, and it wasn't due to just a variability in the field. So using a cover crop can help out in different ways. Besides covering the soil and making sure that your erosion, your soil leaving the field is minimized, it also can help with trafficability so that you're not using as much fuel for the tractor to be in the field, and you can go further without getting stuck. So that's always a benefit. One, because it's drier, and two, because you're building those aggregates that act like mini columns in the soil and help hold up the weight of equipment. So they have multiple aspects that are beneficial to them. Working with the university, I've been hearing and witnessing more herbicide resistance and more disease resistance out there. And my question is, can we have these cover crops build our soils so that root rots aren't as devastating as they were? Can we minimize disease issues? Can we minimize herbicide resistance because we're not using herbicide as much? That's something I'm very interested in. What we're also finding on these plots is if you have enough biomass out there, it actually can smother out the weeds, and we can go much later before we need an herbicide pass or skip one of the passes altogether. Everything also has its challenges, and with cover crops, you have to plant them, so that's going to take fuel, and you also have to terminate them. Sometimes you can do that with your weed pass as well, so you can hit both at the same time. But we do have more fuel being used when you put down cover crops. Now, if the farmer decides to forgo tillage to do cover crops, then you've kind of got one in the same. And actually, tillage takes more fuel than just running over the field applying cover crops. What we find with cover crops to get better establishment so you get quicker growth and usually more growth would be to drill the seed into the soil. We can do that after wheat, we can do that after silage, but we can't do that after corn. Our season just isn't long enough. Occasionally you can luck out, but there's no guarantee. So you have to broadcast it in corn as the corn is senescing. So you don't get quite the germination rate and emergence rate. What I like about drilled is you can actually plug some of the holes so that you have the rye just in between the rows, and then you can plant your beans to the side, and that way they're not being in direct competition. But there's a lot of different ways that farmers are doing this. They're tweaking it so it works in their fields, and that's what's most interesting. So this year, what we're seeing is the plots that the rye was drilled in last fall, they definitely germinated much better. They grew so quickly this spring as well. And if you terminated them after planting, that was too late. They were too tall. But the ones that were aerially applied or by drone, not as much of that germinated. Also because there's residue out there that blocks the seed finding the soil. That actually really decreased how much germinated. So we're finding that whether you drill it or aerial apply it is going to get you a different emergence. And then you need to use a different seeding rate to compensate for that. So when you're drilling in cover crops, you can use a lot less seed because you're going to have better emergence anyway. At Morris, at the Research and Outreach Center, the rye, even at 20 pounds, is smothering out the crop. It really had a good take. In just a few short weeks, we'll be out here harvesting with way wagons and weighted grain carts so that we know which each of the plots are doing. As for profit out in these fields, what we find is that if they go to no-till, and then they decrease the cost because they're using no-till and not tilling out there, that can cover the cost of cover crop. And there's also a lot of programs now, more and more coming out. There's programs from NRCS, Soil and Water, the carbon programs out there, the markets, they also have programs, and these can help offset the cost of cover crops. Now, what cover crops give you, and it's hard to put a dollar value on, is trafficability, being able to get out into that field before your neighbors can. How do you put a price on that? You have better water infiltration and better water usage. So the cover crops is using that water in the spring so that you can get into that field earlier, get it planted. But then you got to watch the weather that it doesn't dry out, because then you need to terminate that crop before it starts taking moisture from your primary crop. The other thing that it does is it gives you nutrients. You get more carbon from it, you get nitrogen and phosphorus and sulfur, and it helps build the soil and make a more healthy soil. And those are things that are really hard to quantify. If you can get those programs for the first 3-5 years and get started, I think you'll just see such benefits from it, it'll be worth the cost. Cover crops can also help with pulling down carbon from the atmosphere, sequestering it into the soil. But you need more growth for that. You can't just have little plants out there. They're doing other things, the roots are doing things, but you need to get biomass. But we need to watch how much biomass so it doesn't affect our primary crop. The thing about cover crops is that they have carbon in them. When you see dried residue, it's about 45-50% carbon. All living plants have carbon in them. And the more biomass, plant biomass that you can get out there, the more carbon you're being able to capture from the atmosphere, because green plants take CO2 from the atmosphere and they turn it into sugars, and they feed the soil about 30% of those sugars to feed microbes. So the more biomass you have, the more you're capturing that carbon from the atmosphere. Now, we only have really one crop in Minnesota that does that well, and that's corn. The other ones don't have enough biomass to help build our carbon substantially. And those are great crops to add these cover crops to, because you can get more carbon from the cover crops. But in Minnesota, we're cold. And a lot of times when we put down these cover crops, they don't get growing very well in the fall. If you put down ones that winter killed, then you have no chance in the spring to capture any carbon. This year, we got the opposite problem, where it was so wet that we couldn't plant, and we got lots of cover crop biomass. The rye took off. The other thing about agriculture that's great is that we have the soil that can sequester this carbon. We can hold more carbon into our soil. Now, the higher your organic matter level is in your soil, the slower it's going to change. And in Minnesota, we're blessed with 3, 4, 5, 6% organic matter, and it's going to change very slowly. But it's a benefit to the farmer to have higher organic matter levels. For farmers with grain crops, you are releasing carbon dioxide from the soil when you go over it. It's a gas in the soil, and so when you turn the soil, you're going to release some of it back up to the atmosphere. Now, the deeper you go, the more aggressive your tillage is, or the more passes that you make, make it even a higher CO2 loss from your soil. So by reducing your tillage, you're keeping a lot more of that carbon dioxide in the soil, and you're also using less fuel. Quite a few Minnesota farmers are able to do no-till beans, which is great. So with the farmers that we're working with, I think one is chisel plow, two are vertical till, the rest are no-till. And no-till, you don't have the tillage passes and the fuel use there. So you are reducing the amount of carbon that you are emitting. So when you're looking at kind of the carbon output from these different methods, if you have a tall boy Hagie, you are going out there and using fuel, but it's kind of a one and done pass. So you do have the carbon emissions from the fuel. And with the drone, you don't have fuel costs, but the drone can only do about 14 acres an hour. So it's going to take a long time. And with the airplane, then you have the fuel costs there as well. As the atmosphere warms up, we're getting more and more extreme weather events. And these are very detrimental to farming. We're getting intense rainfalls, and we're also getting more drought pockets. And the problem with this is our soil has to be able to respond and still help grow a healthy crop. So by sequestering the carbon into the soil, by doing the soil health practices, One, it helps the atmosphere by using less carbon and also sequestering, pulling down some carbon, but it also makes our soil more resilient to these changes. One of my favorite benefits to having either no-till or very reduced till and keeping a lot of residue out there, or having a cover crop over the winter, is reducing erosion, protecting the soil. And again, with these extreme weather events that we're getting, and last year we had one of the windiest winters on record, and we saw our soil flying, taking airborne, moving to the ditches, moving to the atmosphere. And clay, one particle of clay is microscopic. It blows away so easily, and it's vital that we keep our soil covered. And reducing tillage and adding cover crops does that. It's our best soil that's being eroded away. It's the topsoil where your nutrients are, your organic matter, and we don't want to lose that out of our field. We have some of the best soils in Minnesota compared to the whole world, and we want to keep them in our field where they can grow productive crops and stay out of our waterways. So in this field, we killed the rye at planting, and let's see, it's down on the ground and it's decomposing nicely. It's not in the way of our soybean plants, and that's what we're trying to achieve, where you have a mat on the surface of the soil, helps weeds from germinating, and also helps with rain getting into the soil very quickly, because a raindrop can throw soil particles 3 to 5 feet, and anything that we can do to protect the soil would help with water management. So by reducing tillage, you keep a lot more of the residue out there, and this acts like a blanket to the soil. And it also helps from the wind picking up soil particles and the water washing them away. So whether you have the big corn stalks out there or you have rye, helps cover the soil and protect it. By protecting the soil, you end up with better water infiltration, especially if these are standing, left standing in the field. They act like straws in the field, and they just wick down water into the soil really quickly. If you have better water management, you have more resiliency with your crop. It's better able to live through the droughty times and recover after quick flooding. So when you're looking at this dried up residue out in the field, remember that about 50% of this is carbon. So the more biomass you can have out there, the higher your yields, the more carbon you're putting down in the soil. Adding cattle to a field has some real benefits to it as well. One, they're not in confinement where their excrement has to be moved out and you have to bring food in. So that takes carbon to do those things. If you have a cow out in the pasture or out in a field after it's been harvested, then you don't have to move their manure. They're moving it around for you, and their food source is right there. And so that is really good at helping from emitting carbon to the atmosphere and using less fertilizers out on the field. Also, for people who own livestock, it's a real benefit to put them onto the fields that have cover crops and a lot of crop residue out there, because it extends the pasture season for them and they don't have to go back into confinement where you have to feed them bales. It's a benefit to both the grain farmer and the livestock farmer.
Here at NRCS, we make sure to incorporate the research that's conducted by the University of Minnesota into our recommendations and our standards to make sure that everything fits the whole state of Minnesota in a way that is productive and research-based. If you have any questions about how cover crops and other climate-smart practices fit into your operation, be sure to check with your local NRCS field office.